We've been looking quite a bit at dependency injection in .NET Core and .NET 5, and we've covered quite a lot of aspects of it, and if you've missed any of that, do look at the previous videos on that. But all the examples we've had so far have been in ASP.NET applications, so web-based applications. Actually, I was showing you an MVC application, but it worked very similarly in Web API. But because .NET Core is so much built around that, it sometimes gets forgotten that you can use dependency injection in any type of application. And so it could be a desktop GUI application, or it could be something like that. But I'm going to show you in the simplest form you can have, just in a console application. Now let's have a quick reminder of what we put together. So we'll look at the web application first, just run it up to show the services that we're putting together. And here we had this idea of book reviews. So we had this list of reviews, ratings by different people for a variety of books. You can see the individual ratings that people have given there. Or we had the summary page where for each one of the titles, we are just getting an average of all of those ratings. And I did that so that I could show you the idea of injecting one object into another. So we had our book review repository, which just got the data from the database and returned all the reviews for all of the books or the reviews for a particular title. And then we had this aggregator, and into the aggregator, we had injected that repository, and then it did the calculation to do the summary where we get the average for each book. So that was it in the ASP.NET application. Now let's have a look at a console application that will use the same services. So I've got exactly the same services put together. There's a review aggregator taking the repository. The only slight difference I've got there, rather than connecting to a database, just because it would take a bit more time, I've just got some fake data in that repository, but it will still work in the same way. So let's have a look at our program. And I've put a bit of a framework together here. What I've done is I've put together a config. So that's where in our program we're going to be configuring, doing the add transient, the add singleton, and that sort of thing. I've then got use, which I'm calling just a couple of times by way of example. So this is where we're going to get the data from the dependency injection, and then a shutdown because we have to do some tidy up for ourselves, which in the ASP.NET application was done for us. And so the first thing I need to do is actually declare our dependency injector object. And you're only going to have one of these. Exactly where you put it is, again, going to depend on what type of application you've got, be it a WPF or something like that. But for this console application, I'm just going to say have a static service provider, and let's give that a name, service provider, so just call it exactly the same thing, and let's give it a public get so that anyone in the application could use it, even though I'm actually only going to use it from within here. And then we'll give it a private set because that's where it's going to be configured once and once only. And that, as you'd expect, comes in this config. And so here we'll say service provider, that property we've just declared, equals, and then we say new service collection. And then on the service collection, we say dot build service provider. Okay, so we create the service collection, and then build service provider gives us this provider that goes in there. And then the thing we've got to remember to do in the shutdown is we've got to get rid of that. It's disposable, so simply enough we can just say service provider ?dispose, and that will tidy up, presuming it's been created. Now the thing about that though is, although I've created the service provider, I have not configured any injectable services as part of that. And so that actually goes in here. That's why we have the two phases to it, because before we build the provider, that's when we can configure it. And so in here, I can do something like, let's do an add transient, and then we've got our I book review repository that we want to have as book review repository. And then we can concatenate these together. So we'll do another add transient, and in this case, I review aggregator and review aggregator. So exactly the same code, just in a slightly different context from what we've seen in all of the examples before. But we can see that's where they go, then build a service provider, and they're available to anyone in the program. So that's our config and our shutdown, just called once each, as we can see. And then let's have a bit of code, which again could be anywhere in our application. We've put it directly here in the console. And so what we're going to do is quite similar to what we saw in the ASP.NET example, where we can just say var, and then let's say repos for our repository, equals, and then we've got this service provider. And on that, as I say, very similar to what we saw before, we can just do a get required service. So if you saw that video, remember the way this works is it gives you the service if it's available, and it throws an exception if the service hasn't been configured. So we're saying we want whatever service has been configured for the iBook Review Repository interface, and that gives us our repos. And then we'll do exactly the same thing for the aggregator. So we'll say aggreg equals, and then we'll just grab that code and get hold of that interface. And so now we'll get our aggregator and our repository based on what we've got there. And then just to save a little time, I put in here just the loops that are going to take us through the all on the repository and then the summary on the aggregator, and then just print them out to the console. So if we just run that up, we'll see that, remember, we call that use twice, so that's why we've got them listed twice, but we've got the raw data, and then we've got the average data, and then just the same thing again. So it's showing us basically the same information as we had in the website version, but just on the console. So we can see that's how you can make use of it. And really, that's all there is to it, that we need to have some way of configuring this thing, making it globally available. We set up our dependency injection rules, remember to dispose it, and then whenever you want to get hold of a registered service, you can just get hold of the service provider and do get service or get required service, and it will give you it back. The other issue we've got to talk about, though, is something that we talked about before, the idea of the lifetime, the scope of these things. And once again, I have put into those two services this GUID, so it creates a new GUID each time an object of the service is created, and that way we can see what the lifetime is. Now, both of these I have configured as transient so far, which, as you should remember, means we get a brand new one every time that it's asked for. And so, simple thing we can do here is just print those out. So we're going to do a console write, and then we'll say repository, then we'll say repos.id, so that will give us the GUID for the repository, and then we're going to have the aggregator, and in there we'll have aggreg.id. And then remember, what we want to do is also look at the other repository, because remember, the aggregator has a repository injected into it. So we've got two different repositories that may be the same thing, maybe different things, depending on the way we do the configuration. So we're going to have, let's just call this inner repository, and that's going to be aggreg.repository.id. And then let's just tidy that up so they'll all line up nicely, and put in an extra blank line there. And so if we run that up now, remembering that these are both transient, and we can see that they've each got their unique ID, but the important thing is, because they're transient, each time we asked for the repository, we got a different one, and therefore we're getting different numbers on those two of them. If, on the other hand, I went for singleton, then we would see that we're getting not only the same number for the two repositories within the one use, but in fact, when we call use again, this is why I put it in twice, you can see we're getting exactly the same numbers again, because singleton means for the entire lifetime of the application, you'll only ever get each service created once. But then remember, we have this third idea, which is the idea of scoped. So we could set each of these to be scoped. And when we did that in the ASP.NET application, what that meant was that the objects would be created once per request response lifecycle. So if you had a situation where within a single request sent to the web server, the processing's done, however many services of a particular type you had, you'd only get one object. So we saw that we only got the one repository, even though we'd got it in two places, but then the next time we got a different one as well. So it's not like singleton where you never get a new one, but you only get one per cycle. But of course, that's very specifically tied into what ASP.NET's all about, because we have this idea of request and response. If you're doing any other type of application, although we can still have the concept of scope, it's really up to you to decide what you mean by scope. So if this were a GUI application in WPF, you might, for example, decide, well, given a particular button press, all of the activity that is generated from that button press will count that as a single scope. So any services created should only be created once. But then when a different button's pressed, that could be a different scope. I'm not really going to offer a particular solution to this. I'm far more experienced in the web side of things than desktop side of things these days. But that's just the sort of example of how you might do it. But how do we actually get that in there? Because at the moment, if I leave that on scoped and we haven't done anything to specify what we mean by scope, then when we run it up, we'll in fact get exactly the same behavior as singleton. So you can see that those numbers are repeating each time around. If we want to scope it, we've got to specify when we are beginning and ending our scope. And the way we do it is like this. What we have to do is introduce into here an actual scope object. So I'm going to say using, because it's disposable, and then I'm going to say var scope equals, and then on the service provider, I say create scope. Okay, so that begins a new scope. So somewhere in an ASP.NET application, when a request comes in, that code or something like it is being called to begin the scope. And then because we've done it with a using, when we leave the code block for that use, then the dispose will automatically be called, and so that will signify the end of the scope. So that has given us a scope block. And then the only other thing we have to do is we don't call the service provider directly, we call a service provider that is provided within the scope. So we can see scope itself has a property called service provider, which then has this get required service. So if we put that on there, then we will get the scope behavior. So now when we run it up, we can see that within a single scope, we're only getting the one repository. So those two are the same. But then on the new scope, the second time we call use, then although again they're the same as each other, it's different from the initial repository. So that's given it exactly that scope behavior. The difference from ASP.NET though is we get to decide when a scope begins and ends. And if you do like that, that'll be consistent, because if we then do go for the other approaches, so if let's say we go for singleton once again, it doesn't matter that we're getting this through a scope, it will still have the singleton behavior. So when we run that up, we'll see we're getting exactly the same numbers each time. So actually, for safety's sake, you should really be doing that for yourself. Okay, so that's really my final one for .NET dependency injection. We've covered a lot of stuff over those various videos, but I hope it's been helpful. If you liked it, do click the like button, do subscribe. If you want to know anything more about dependency injection, do let me know, and I'll see you next time.